trying to open up with a word. Taylor Jesus, we thank you for another night to be able to come in here and praise and worship you. We just thank you to lift our hands and our voices to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Your presence will rest on us tonight, and I thank you, Holy Spirit, for having your way in and throughout this service. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. in my testimony. This is my testimony.
Hallelujah, singing hallelujah, One more night, you lost breath. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise God. He's worthy. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Man, I'm thankful for Jesus. Lord, y'all flip the lights on. Where's the light flippers? Huh? You'll have to ask the praise and worship leader about that one service ahead of time, okay? Well, it's who's the praise and worship leader? Your daddy. Guess what time it is, Marty? Offering time. Oh, you don't want to do it now because you didn't get to sing? My gosh. I'm glad Lolo's here. Oh, well, Leonard, I didn't know. You didn't tell me. Y'all got to fill me in on stuff like this. I mean, yeah, but I'm talking about before, and I said one service ahead of time, too. All right, you gonna, what are you going to sing to God? A slap awesome?
You need your mic.
Lion King, you ain't watched it yet. Oh, get your microphone and hold it. Okay, you off the panel. Okay, you go, girl. You off, get back to here. She don't. I know she's cute,
but there you go. Well, get comfy. That's all right. You better get ready. You have to stand up and sing what? There we go.
You got to unmute the bottom of the computer screen. You got to unmute the one over there. Computer, you got to go to the third one. Go to the third one. Yeah. Are you going to get with it? You're the shy one, ain't you?
Let the lion roar. You know. She's little, so that was precious. And we don't do that here, but you know, right, God? She was precious. Amen. I felt Mike as long as I didn't have him up here doing it. So he didn't love it. He could crawl on the stage like that.
She was being the lion.
I know. She was. You are really. You might be in theater one day. Say, raise your hand if you want to offer an envelope. Raise your hand if you want to offer an envelope. Look at them. They get their hands up. Girl, you got pen. You can't. You need one more hand. Give her an offer.
There is one. It's right there.
Make her get it herself, right?
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Y'all don't forget Sunday was Mission Sunday. I think everybody might have forgot, but we only had about a couple people put in mission. So remember. Hallelujah. Well, glory. It's offering time.
Glory.
Hallelujah. Anybody got a praise report tonight? Just make sure if you can, when you put through, if you can, when you do the Cash App or Venmo, fill it out. If you don't fill it out, I'll fill it out. But if you can, make sure you fill it out so you can put on there where it's going to, you know, and all that. Like, you put in tonight through Cash App, and you're going to put in missions for Sunday, you need to put it on there. Missions on there as a note so I know it's for missions. Or fill out an envelope that says Cash App and then missions. Amen? Praise God. I'm just trying to get a little clarity because sometimes I have to guess.
So you do see if it's wrote
out. Oh, yeah, if it's on there. If they put it on there, I know. But best to fill out an envelope. That way I know exactly because sometimes I get, you know, I try to, praise God. Sometimes I'm trying to interpret stuff that's wrote out, you know. You know, we're getting hurt. Like I asked, had that cereal. What does that say, cereal? I thought it said starting. It said Israel. I told him that. I said, man, I'll play off on that one. I don't know what we were starting. Miss Linda got a praise report.
Praise God that we had a safe trip from Marianna, excuse me, to Westport and back.
Amen.
Tomorrow morning.
Amen. Praise God. I wasn't going to correct you. We knew what you meant.
Thank you.
You know, Dusty, he might. You know, English teacher over in Jamaica. But we're glad to have Aria tonight. Glory. It's summertime now. She goes, she might come down here and move in with us. She goes back and forth. That girl goes everywhere. Anybody else got a praise report? Praise God. Man, I'm excited. Well, let's take up the offering, Marley. Get that plate. He got the plate. He done took it away from you. Are you going to let him do it? You want Logan to do it? You going to play with start to call her Mariel. You going to play with Ellie? Boy, she might knock you out tonight. Let's say the blessing. Hold on, we got to say the blessing first. All right, let's say the blessing. Not the blessing, we got to say the prayer. Aria, Marley, if you're going to do it, you got to do it the way I tell you. Now come up here and stand while Logan prays over it. Just say it from your heart. Hallelujah. All right, go, girl. Go get them. Go get them. Stand. She said, I thought I got offers. I'm going straight to them. Hallelujah. If you want the June calendars, I already got them out over there, the reading calendar and the calendar for next month, you know. We might have to put some kind of, get one of them shocking systems. We'll try it. Not that way. Don't turn that way. Go that way. We'll get you one too. So y'all be twins together. Okay. All right, let's turn to Matthew chapter 12. We're going to be in the CSV version, the Christian Standard Version. Hallelujah. CSV. We're starting with verse 1 in chapter 12. We got the new versions on the Bible on there, so I'm thankful we got new versions. Amen. You just had to make sure they, when you're reading one different version, a different verse, make sure it lines up, and make sure it goes off the wall somewhere, because then you don't need to use that version for that verse. Especially in the newer King James versions and different like that, they're taking Son of God out of there like 123 times out of the new version. So, you know, we don't need to support that. And if you don't know about it, you don't know it. So you buy a new Bible and don't know that they change it, you won't even read Son of God that much in there. So we got to learn to follow just follow the word, make sure it lines up with what it's supposed to line up with. Amen. So Jesus is teaching them here, you know, he's telling them he's the Lord of the Sabbath. He said at the time Jesus passed through the grain fields on the Sabbath, his disciples were hungry and began to pick and eat some of the heads of grain. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to him, "See, your disciples are doing what is not lawful to do on the Sabbath." Well, Jesus, you know, if it really wasn't lawful for them to do it, see, they done made another law out of it. If it really wasn't lawful for them to do it, Jesus couldn't have done it. He would have told them, do not do that. But see, he had examples. He couldn't give them examples. So that tells me that it wasn't against God's law, it was against the Pharisees' law. Remember, God gave them 10 commandments. They made, I think, 646 commandments out of that. It's just, they just kept adding to it. Why? When somebody done something they didn't like, they added another. If they didn't like this, they added another one. They're the spiritual leaders. I was talking to somebody today. I said, ain't it amazing that Jesus, when you can read about him in the New Testament stuff, he never really got real hard and rebuked sinners. But he sure did rebuke religious people that thought they knew everything and didn't know nothing. Because why? They were deceiving the people. If you start deceiving the people, he going to get after you. You start standing in the way of sinners, causing them not to come to know him, he will get after you because he don't want you to do that. Why? He would that all would come to repentance and come to know him as their Savior. So when they seen this, they said it's not lawful. Well, here's Jesus. He said to them, haven't you read that David, when he and those who were with him were hungry, how they entered the house of God? Surely if it would have been not okay to go through the grain fields and pick some grain off and eat, surely it would have been bad to go into the house of God. But Jesus telling them, he's giving them an example, they entered into the house of God where they had no business being. Because that was for the priest and all that back then. But they done it anyway. Why? Because they were hungry. They ate bread of the presence, which is not lawful for him or for those with him to eat, but only for the priest. Or haven't you read in the law that on the Sabbath day the priest in the temple violate the Sabbath and are innocent? I tell you that something greater than the temple is here. He's trying to point everything to all this stuff is about to change, and he's standing right in front of you. I'm about to change all this stuff. And I'm standing right here in front of him. They couldn't even see who he was because they wanted their own agenda. They wanted to walk by their own set of standards. They wanted to walk by their feelings and nobody else's. You can't walk by your feelings. If you do, guess what? You're not going to follow Jesus. If you walk by your feelings, write that down on your mirror at home, you ain't going to follow Jesus because he's not walking in his feelings. And he's trying to kill us, get rid of us, so he can live through us. So Jesus is not going to be a feeling being. He's going to be a word being. And that's what he told me and you, we need to be his word being. Somebody put something on Facebook by Warren Wiersbe, and he said, trusting God means thinking and acting according to God's word in spite of any of my circumstances, any kind of feelings I have, or any consequences. I'm not supposed to walk in my circumstances and talk. I'm not supposed to walk in feelings I have and talk. I'm not supposed to walk in anything, any consequences that come in my life and talk. I should only talk when the words come out of my mouth to eradicate the feelings, eradicate the circumstance, and eradicate the consequences. Hello? Man, how much of a better life we live if the word came of us all the time and not what we thought, not what we felt, but the word came out of us. And it was what Jesus said, what he tell us, how he told us to live. If we would learn to listen to him and do exactly what he said, a lot of things that might in your life would change. Imagine if you spend your whole life in church and get to heaven and your name ain't in the Lamb's Book of Life. All that time you wasted coming to church thinking you following him and you ain't following him because you want to walk according to what your standards, the way you think it's supposed to be, like the scribes and Pharisees did, instead of the way he says, this is the way to do it. I just fully believe a lot of people not going to heaven because they can't forgive people. Because the Father can't forgive them, and they're going to make you think they okay, but they in their feelings. They mad at people, hurt at people, upset with people, whether it be people, government, places. They've let that store in them, and you know what the devil does when you got all that in you? He just feeds you. You have all kind of thoughts coming in your mind against that person, against that business, against this over here, that over there. He's going to feed what you let rest in your heart. How does he know it's in your heart? Anybody know?
Because he knows everything.
No, the devil. Oh. How does the devil? You made one of my mistakes last week. How does the devil know what's in your heart? That's his guy, but he won't say it. Yeah, it's your mouth. He don't know what's. He don't know what's in my heart or my mind until I open my mouth and tell him. And then when I tell him, and I ain't talking about the devil. I'm talking about the demons. If you attract the devil himself, you're really doing something. The little demons most times can take care of me and you. Because we haven't matured and grown in Christ enough to where they have to go back and tell the generals. But we grow in Christ, we have them scampering. And what's the best way for you to grow in Christ? Walk in love. Forgive people. Don't let it bother you. Let it go. Don't talk about it. And that's it, man. It's over. As far as I'm concerned, as far as they're concerned, it may not be over. But they got to live. Now, I got to get forgiveness for me. Amen? I have to forgive for me. So I don't walk in that where the devil can torment me with that over and over and over. Because he will torment you if you let him. People don't like hearing they got devils. But guess what? If you ain't following Jesus, you got devils. They've come to you. They're talking to you. They're on your shoulder. They're in your house. Hello, if you got animals, they'll jump on them. Make them act crazy and stupid. Hello, I remember, I've told the story several times, over my cousin's house and his dog wagging his tail up on the fence, you know, shaking its head, wagging its tail. Man, I reached over to pet the dog. He went, rawr, rawr, rawr. I told my cousin, I said, that dog's got devils. I said, I don't know what y'all doing around here, but this dog's about half crazy. You know? And whatever's on you can get on your animals, and it can get on your kids. Why? How's it get on your kids? You talk about it and talk about it and talk about it. We used to have people in the church, you know, clean the church. You could tell they talk about it at home because the kids would jump on people because you touched the windows. Well, that's what we pay them for, to clean the church. It's got to get dirty for you to clean it. Amen. So you got to be careful what you talk about, especially around your kids. You'll turn your kids against people in the church, and the only way you know it is because you see them the next time and they won't even come up and hug you or nothing. Because you've talked and you've turned. And then you want to tell me you're okay going to heaven, everything's okay. No, you're in offense, you're gossiping, and you're spreading things and causing the devils to be able to act on things that come out of your mouth. Hallelujah. So don't go through all this. You got to have a genuine relationship with Jesus Christ to make it to heaven. You can't just go to church and think you got everything okay. Hello, you got to obey Jesus, follow him every day, and do what he tells you to do. Amen. And then Jesus told him here. He said, verse 6, I tell you that something greater than the temple is here, which is him. If you have known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the innocent, for the Son of Man is the Lord of the Sabbath. Man, he's the Lord of the Sabbath. Jesus is the Lord of the Sabbath. He said, if you knew what I was talking about the Sabbath, what did he say? You'd have showed mercy.
I desire mercy for people, not just a sacrifice all the time. Amen? I desire for mercy to come and for you to show mercy. And that's what we can learn from Luke, 6:38, because that's what it talks about in Luke 6:38 when it says, "Give it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over." It ain't talking about money before that. It's talking about mercy, forgiveness, grace. Giving people that when you need it, it'll come back to you. Hallelujah. Now it's up to the people to still give it to you. Right, God? Man, people need to learn that Jesus is in love with them. He just in love with them. Hallelujah. But you got to let him love you. Remember, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son on the cross. That's where it ends. That's where unconditional love ends. The next verse will tell you what to do. He who believes on him, relies on him, clings to him, trusts in him. That's the person that will have every everlasting life. Why? Because the love of God that's shed on there and it's unconditional will come off of that cross, get inside of you and clean you and get all that junk out of you if me and you will let it. But we got to let it. If you want to walk what you want to do and say what you want to say, guess what? He'll let you do it. He'll let you wallow around and everything. If you want to do it, he'll let you do it. I know. Man, I went through it. Like people talk about you and tell you that, you don't understand it because all you ever did was really just love them. But yet, it's your fault. They got to blame somebody for them wanting to do what they want to do. Hello, because really, they're just doing what they want to do. Man. Like I said Sunday, over the past 23 years, the people that we've had that's left this church, and then they want to talk about me and say this and that, but all we ever did was love them here, and if I could tell you the stuff that we done for them, you would say, my God, I don't know why they'd ever be mad at you. But we don't tell when we help people. A lot of churches tell. They'll tell you, I did this, I did that. What difference does that make? If they manage, they manage. Ain't nothing you can say to do anything about it. Except pray for what? The eyes of their understanding be open to how much Jesus really loves. Because that's the only thing that will really change me and you. When you really see how much he loves you, it'll change you. It'll make you shut your mouth. Hello. It'll make you get in his presence. It'll make you want to be with him if you really see how much he really loves you. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. The man with the shriveled head here, he was moving on from there. You know, Jesus, when you read it, he went from thing to thing to thing to thing. You know, we think, Pastor Robert, he may get off track when he's preaching sometimes. All we got to do is read one chapter of Jesus. He went from thing to thing. He was shotgun messaging them all the time. So I learned from the best, I guess. He went from this one to that one over there, back to this. And he said right there, moving on from there. And if we follow him, we'll all time do things that are right. So, moving on from there, he entered the synagogue. There he saw a man who had a shriveled hand. And in order to accuse him, they asked him. They're setting him up. Is it lawful? Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? Jesus, you done got on every nerve we got. We mad as fire at you. We want to kill you. We just don't know how to do it. Are you going to tell us it's lawful to heal somebody on the Sabbath too? Man, Jesus, Jesus is smart. Why? He didn't say nothing unless the Father said it. Amen. The Father knows everything. He replied to them, who among you, if you got a sheep that's fallen in a ditch or in a pit on the Sabbath, wouldn't take hold of it and lift it out? You going to let that sheep just stay in there and suffer to the mark of the Sabbath? No, you're going to say, well, in this case, this is my sheep. I don't want it to die. So I'm going to save my money here and I'm going to get it out of the ditch. So you can do stuff. He's telling the Pharisees, you can do stuff when it benefits you. But this man here that has a wilted hand, it ain't okay for me to help him and heal him on the Sabbath and give him freedom and victory. He's telling him, yes, you're doing this. It's the same thing. Next verse 12, a person is worth far more than a sheep. Man, ain't y'all glad to hear that? That a person is worth far more than a dog. A person is worth far more than a cat. A person is worth far more than a horse. I know all you animal lovers, if you listen, you get mad. But if you love animals more than people, you're wrong.
That's right.
Jesus done told us right here. He tells us that people are more important than animals. Far more important to him than animals. So you got to lean towards people before you lean towards your animal.
The animals don't
care. Right? That's right. They ain't going. Well, people argue they're going to heaven or hell. I got no idea. Probably nowhere. But I ain't gonna fight about it. If I get up to heaven and Princess is there, I'm just gonna have to interview her and say, how'd you make it? Praise. I think it made me over here. Give me the eye because of Princess. I mean, you know, that's all dog, you know, praise God we had in our house. I think you had a devil. But the way they treated her, the devil entered into her. That dog will look at you and bite you. And you pray God. When you throw a dog and pillows back and forth at each other, they make it a little weird. Try throwing you in a pillow back and forth in the dark. See, if you don't come out a little weird. Hallelujah. Well, we know we got spirit, soul, and body. We would have to come out of that pillow and say, I forgive you and forget it. That's the only way you get over it. I don't care what people do to you. The only way you will get through it is if you have to come out saying, I forgive you and I'm going to forget it. And forgetting means I'm not going to hold it against you. I remember what you've done and I'm not going to let myself get set up for that to happen again. In other words, I forgave you, but I don't trust you as far as I can throw it. It's like the illustration I was told several times about somebody, you know, that stole money from me and I forgave them, but I'm not going to let them take my money and go make a deposit at the bank, especially cash. Check, I may get around that, but not no cash. May not never see it again. Well, and they probably come back and say, well, you forgot to put the cash in there. No. I handed it to you, crazy. But, you know, that's why forgiveness ain't really tied to I forgave this person, now I trust them just like I did before. I've always said, Yvette, if she was to have an affair on me, I'd have to forgive her. But I wouldn't trust her leaving the house for a while. I'd probably get some drones and fly them around the house. I thank God I got a wife. I don't have to worry about that. There's so many women out there, you can be around them, listen to them talk, and you wonder, are they really faithful to their husband? The way they talk. I mean, a woman shouldn't carry on conversations with a man about things that ain't got nothing to do with a relationship that she should be having that talk with her husband. Not with just a man at work or a same thing with a man having a conversation with a woman at work. That shouldn't be going on. You ought to tell them, oh, no, I don't want to hear that. What are you talking about? You need to go home and talk to your husband and wife about that. Don't be talking to me about it. That ain't got nothing to do with me. Hallelujah. Because if you don't, you're setting yourself up for things to happen in your life. Hello. They vet told me one time this guy, he was hitting on her and stuff at work, you know, and she finally just told him, you know, my husband's 350 pounds.
Maybe 450.
This was back then, Ciro. Be quiet. About 350 pounds, you know, and you have to, and people think, he probably didn't know she had a husband at home. But see, you got to be quick to speak up when you got a wife or husband at home, then I don't play with that. You're not entertaining me with that. I have no thoughts for you in that way. And see, what gets you is when they may be good looking or beautiful, they think that they can sway you because of their looks. But when you're walking in Jesus, no matter what they look like, if they're walking according to the devil, they make you want to vomit. That's how bad it looks because the insides ain't right. Hello. And then somebody put up, this is another thing somebody put, I think it was on David Wilkerson's page. When you have the Holy Spirit inside of you, secular music won't sound the way it used to. When you really got the Holy Ghost in you, secular music don't sound the way it used to. Certain jokes don't make you laugh like they used to. Going to places and being around people that dishonor God won't feel okay like it used to. See, when you really got the Holy Ghost inside you, He changes you. You don't be around all that stuff no more. You don't be around where the devil's being glorified and Jesus ain't being glorified. So you gotta make sure that you stay in Him. Amen? Then He told the man, stretch out your hand. Because He's telling him, it's lawful for me to do on the Sabbath what I'm doing. Verse 13. Then stretch out your hand. So he stretched it out, and it was restored as good as the other one. Completely restored as good as the other. Why ain't we seeing miracles like this right in church? Jesus was doing this all the time. So why ain't we seeing this now in churches like we should see it? And I fully believe there's something wrong with us somewhere. He needs to tell us what it is, but we got to seek Him to tell us, and we're not going to find it. Find the answer from Him watching Price is Right all the time. Let's make a deal. That's two I like to watch. You know, you're not going to find, you can put your TV show in there that you like to watch. We're not going to find that missing link if we're always doing worldly stuff. You know, you got to get to his feet. You got to find out what he wants. That's Spence Williams for raised 6 people from the dead. But during the day while he was up, he read his Bible for 30 minutes, then prayed 30 minutes, then read his Bible for 30 minutes, then prayed 30. He did that over and over all day long. He didn't have a TV in his house, didn't have newspapers, didn't have magazines, and he raised 6 people from the dead. And people want to criticize him, and I tell them, whenever you raise 6 people from the dead, you come and talk to me then.
Amen.
Hello, when you get people healed, like he got them healed, didn't come and talk to me. Don't be telling me things and you ain't even did what the man did. Jesus said, greater works than these shall you do, and even greater than that we'll do. We know salvation is the greater work. But he didn't mean leave the other ones behind. He said we would do them and greater. So me and you are supposed to be healing the sick, raising the dead, casting out devils, laying our hands on the sick and they recover. That's what we're supposed to be doing as believers, not as pastors, teachers, evangelists, prophets, and apostles. As believers, me and you are supposed to be able to go out in this world and get people set free by the power of the Holy Ghost.
He says, greater things you will do if you want.
Huh?
If you want.
Greater things.
He said you should do these and even greater things.
Okay, if you want.
I don't know. I don't know what you're trying to say.
What I'm trying to say that if you in line with what he's telling him to do, like he was on connection with the Father all the time.
Yes, you got to hear what the Father says and do it.
If you're not separated the way he's separated, waiting for the Father to tell you what to do.
Exactly. It all comes back to hearing what Jesus says and doing it.
Amen.
Hearing what Jesus said. I thought you were trying to tell me something else in that verse. That wasn't in that verse.
No,
you got to hear. Jesus said, I don't do nothing unless the Father tells me. I don't say nothing unless he tells me. Me and you got to get out of our mouth. I don't do nothing unless the Spirit tells me. I don't say nothing unless the Spirit tells me. Because the Spirit is, he's the God of this age right now. Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. The Spirit is here. So he's the one that we should listen to and do what he says, because he was sent to lead us, guide us, protect us, watch over us, and take care of us. So he's the one we listen to. You know, and he ain't going to do nothing outside of the Father and outside of Jesus. So we got to learn to listen to him and do exactly what he says. Then the next verse, right after he has the man hand restored, the Pharisees left there, went out, plotted against him, how they might kill him. Man, they loved him so much they wanted to know if he was going to heal on the Sabbath. Then when he done it, they wanted to go out and kill him. Be careful, people that love you like that. Hello? Be careful, people that act like they love you, but then they'll stab you in the back and talk about you and tear you down and blame everything on you, and they don't want to put the knife in your back. Praise God. And it can be in your family. It can be friends. It can be co-workers. It can be church people. Because people come to church don't mean they're going to heaven, y'all. Hello? You got to see a change. You got to be a fruit inspector. Are they producing fruit, or are they producing bud? Are they always blatantly trying to hurt people, or are they always bad trying to say, teach me what the word says so I can live by it? Well, praise God anyway. Hello? Just like Sunday when we minister, it matters what camp you're in, because that's what you hear. That's the instructions you hear. If God sent you to this camp, then he's getting you ready for something to hear what Jesus says and do it. He sends you to another camp, you get over there, he probably didn't send you because they ain't preaching the word, and you over there, and they tell you can do whatever you want to, and grace covers it, live like you want to, do what you want to, it don't matter. God's done did everything. When you die, everybody's going to heaven, so don't worry about it. There ain't no hell no more. They're preaching all this stuff right now. Jesus was a homosexual. Jesus had a baby. Jesus slept with a woman. The virgin birth ain't true, you know, and all this stuff against Jesus. You better be careful if you get in a camp that you think you've been fed to and they're not ministering the word. The word is the number one thing. Amen? The word is the number one. You got to hear the word. And when you're doing wrong, you got to hear, I need to repent and get right with Jesus. Not just keep going like I'm going, because if I keep going like I'm going, I started off right, I done got off track, and before I know it, I'm 22 miles away from what God called me to do, and I'm over here telling people I'm okay with him, and I'm offended, upset, and tore up with somebody. Place or fine. Any of it. Man, repent. Make a U-turn. Get back to where you're supposed to be in him. Quit blaming God for everything going on in your life and blame yourself. Look in the mirror. You'll see a familiar person. That is your problem about 90% of the time. You. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hey, preach it, Jesus. Ha, I mean, Pastor. Preach, tell us what Jesus said. Amen. Hello, because you're going to have people out there, when you're living for Jesus, you're going to have people out there want to kill you. They at least want to chew on you. Hello, at least want to do that because they don't agree with what you say. You go out there, like the United Methodist Church, we had one of the pastors here from there. He's having to separate away from them, been with them for years. He's got to separate away from them because they just passed a law, you know, not long ago, where they're going to start ordaining homosexuals and all that, and already have been positions in their churches before they even told them it was going to change the law. And almost all their bishops in their church are women. Y'all, you can't have a woman as a bishop over all the pastors. God said a woman can't rule over a man. And that's what a bishop does in their organization. Rules over the pastors. So you can't get out of line with the word and then try to make it okay. So that shows you how they can go now and go from that and say, I'm going to ordain a homosexual, marry two people together, that man, woman, woman. Because they started getting off track away from Jesus. The stuff we hear about the scribes and Pharisees are probably just a little bit of it. They were probably so screwed up in their life if we knew everything they were going through and doing because they didn't got away from what God said. And me and you will do the same thing. Don't be thinking you can walk away from Jesus' words and still go to church and everything and be out there and think you're okay and you're away from his words. Because you can't. You'll be squirrely, messed up. Hello. That's why, really, you know, as a pastor, over the past 23 years, when women come in and tell me they're over this and over that, I got to watch them for a little while to make sure they ain't crazy. Because they can be crazy in their feelings, man. And get everybody messed up. Well, Pastor hurt my feelings. He told me it was none of my business. Well, if you can't get over that, you sure don't need to be over nothing in the church. Because if you ask me about other people, I'm going to tell you what, it's none of your business. Well, praise God anyway. But they went out and how they might kill him. They was planning, man. They wanted to get rid of Jesus. And then the next one here, in verse 15, we're starting off the servant of the Lord. You know, so Jesus was aware of this and withdrew. Large crowds followed him and he healed them all. Ain't it amazing? See, the scribes and Pharisees, what they do? They sent out spies to go with the big crowds to report back to them what he was doing. But you know why they was really messed up with him? The large crowds were following him and not them. It's jealousy. They got jealous, man. They got upset with him. He's pulling the people away from us. You know, them people, man, I used to see them. They were in synagogue at church. Man, I ain't seen them in a couple of months now. I wonder if he's getting that money. I don't know. That made a man upset. He was taking people away from him. The large crowd followed him. Man, some of these people ain't never been in church. Why they following him for? We know the way. No, Jesus said, I'm the way. So they got jealous. But guess what happened? They followed him. He healed them all. He healed every single one of them. So Jesus telling me and you here how to be a servant of the Lord. You know, part of being the servant of the Lord is getting people healed. That's part of being a servant of the Lord. Getting people delivered and set free. That's part of being his servant. Verse 16. He warned them not to make him known. Jesus always tell them, don't tell people about me. Next verse. He already knew they were going to tell everybody about him when they got healed. I mean, you know. Praise. He knew you. That's why he didn't tell them. He warned them not to make him known. Next verse. 17. Flip over. Okay. It's froze up, I guess. So that what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. What was spoken through the prophet Isaiah? Well, that's verse 18. Here is my servant. Isaiah prophesied this years ago. Here is my servant. Who's the servant? Jesus. They expected Jesus to step on the scene and be this king that's ruling everybody, and he was. But they didn't realize the king was a servant too. He was a servant. He washed their feet. Whom I have chosen, my beloved in whom I delight. My beloved in whom I delight. This is the Father talking about Jesus here through Isaiah. I will put my spirit on him, and he will proclaim justice to all the nations. He will not argue. Next verse. He will not argue and shout. Is that thing going slow by there? And no one will hear his voice in the streets. Why? They didn't want to listen. They didn't want to listen to him. Man, he's saying stuff they don't want to hear. He will not break a bruised reed. He will not put out a smoldering wick until he has led justice to victory. Man, Jesus was all about people seeing justice in their life. Getting what they deserve, not getting what they didn't deserve. Getting what they deserve, and then he died on the cross so we in sin we wouldn't get what we deserved. Because we all deserve to go to hell. But he died on the cross so we don't get what we deserve. Amen. So through his cross, he showed us mercy and grace so we don't get what we deserve no more. Amen. But he was about walking in justice. It said the nations will put their hope in his name. Now, I don't know about y'all, but I put my hope in his name. I'm a holy nation, according to 1 Peter 2:9. I'm a holy nation. Amen. I'm a royal priesthood. Glory. That's who I am in Christ. So I say out of my mouth. Amen. I say it out of my mouth. What? The my hope is in Jesus. Verse 21. My hope is in Jesus. And then he goes into a house divided. See this right here? Man, when things are in your house, when things are messed up, when things are not going right, man, go to the Bible and find out why they ain't going right. He might tell you right here in the Word why they ain't going right. Start with verse 22 here. This is called a house that's divided. Amen. Then a demon-possessed man who was blind and unable to speak was brought to him. He healed him so that the man could both speak and see. All the crowds, every one of them was astounded and said, could this be the son of David? I mean, what else has he got to do? He's been doing all kind of stuff, but they're finally seeing all this stuff happen. So now they're getting thoughts, man, could this be the son of David? Could this really be him? Well, the devil's been blinding their eyes the whole time. And the most time he's using the religious people to blind their eyes. That this can't be him, man. It's got to be Beelzebub. This is the devil. The devil's casting out devils here. And Jesus tells him, no, it can't be that way. You can't do stuff like that. So that the man could both speak and see. Next verse. All the crowds were astounded and said, could this be the son of David? Next verse. When the Pharisees heard this, man, they listening to that. They got them ears out there everywhere. Almost sound like the FBI, somebody like that. They bugging everything, bugging their phones, and got somebody standing outside the windows at the houses. You know, listen, this man drives out demons only by Beelzebub, the ruler of demons. They say Jesus is operating, hooking up. He's in partnership with the devil. Next verse. Knowing their thoughts, he told them. How can me and you know the thoughts of people?
By the Holy Spirit.
By the Spirit telling us. He's got to be the one to tell us. And that it can be a gift of the Holy Spirit. It's called discernment of spirits. So you can see what spirit people are led by. But he can let you know what people are thinking if you just... If you just listen. If you just listen, he can talk through you. He can talk a language you ain't never talked before. Hello. I mean, when I was in Pakistan, you know, I didn't understand that language. They all around speaking, talking, you know, saying this language and stuff. I said, Lord, what in the world are they talking about? So he gave me, I thought I was talking in tongues, man. I said out a couple of sentences, and what was his name? Bishop Java. He told him, he said, he's learning our language. I said, I don't even know what y'all talking about. I said, I just was praying in the Spirit. He said, well, you answer them. Praise God, man. Sometimes God wants to stop people in their tracks when they think they know right and know what they're doing. They don't know what they're doing. And he wants to stop them in their tracks. That's why sometimes you might be around somebody who only speaks Chinese. And if you really give yourself to the Holy Ghost, he may talk to them through you. And you think you're just talking in the Spirit and you're talking in Chinese. Hallelujah. Knowing their thoughts, he said to them, every kingdom divided against itself is headed for destruction, and no city or house divided against itself will stand. Well, ain't that the same thing we talked about Sunday, talking about people that get offended and stuff like that? They send a group, John told us, and when they leave, they never should have been with us, because if they stay, all they're going to do is cause confusion if they don't learn to repent, get back to Jesus, and quit talking about stuff. So the way you're going to make it. Man, people just read the Bible. I mean, six things God hates, the seventh thing he detests, so in discord among the brethren. So if I tell you anything against a brother or sister in Christ, and it causes division in you from you to them, I've just did the seventh thing that God detests. That's why you shouldn't be talking about people to other people, because then they got to get something else out of their mind. Hello. Sometimes me and the babies, you know, we over to church, we have to talk about a few things. But I have to immediately go to the Lord and say, get that out of my mind. I don't want to be dwelling on that. I won't think about that. Man, y'all ever had stuff like that happen to keep you up at night? You wake up thinking about it. You're thinking about stuff. And if we would just let Jesus take it out of our mind, it wouldn't be there no more. Hello. No city or house divided against itself will stand. Why is that not? Why can't a house that's divided against itself, why can't it stand? So Jesus said it couldn't. Yeah, Jesus said it couldn't. He said, right there, if it's divided. And even Amos said, how can we walk together if we don't walk in unity? How can we do that? If we don't walk together in unity, we gotta walk. One thing about the scribes and Pharisees, 99% of them was in unity against Jesus. There were a few of them that really heard what he said and questioned him. Next verse. If Satan drives out Satan, he's divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? And he ain't divided. They got a purpose. They're going to do what the devil tells them to do. Next verse. And if I drive out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your sons drive them out? For this reason, they will be your judges. He's telling their sons are going to judge them. Why? They're speaking against him. They speaking against Jesus. He said, "Why? How does y'all's children drive these devils out?" So they must have been doing something right. The scribes and Pharisees wasn't driving out the devils, but their sons and daughters was. Next verse. If I drive out a demon by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. If I drive out a demon by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. When you get free from devils, man, the kingdom of God will come upon you. What's the kingdom of God? His rule, his way of doing things. That'll come upon you, and you'll walk according to what he's told you to walk upon, if me and you'll listen to him and do what he's telling us to do. Next verse. How can someone enter a strong man's house and steal his possessions? I didn't even know I was in the Bible until I read this. Steal his, that was a joke. You laugh, Corbin. Steal his possessions. You're going to nap today. Oh, praise God. Unless the first, he ties up Robert. Ties up the strong man. Then he can plunder his house. Next verse. Anyone who is not with me is against me. Man, that's pretty plain right there to me. If you ain't for Jesus, and how can you be for him? By doing what his word says, hearing what he's got to say and doing. If you're not for him, then anyone who does not gather with me scatters. In other words, you're separating people. Look at the fruit, y'all. Look at people's fruit and see what they're doing when they open their mouth. Are they scattering God's people? Or are they bringing peace to God's people? Are they bringing unity to God's people? Or are they getting rid of God's people? Trying to run them off, wanting them to be on their side. Hook up with them. Agree with them. Now, you better be careful who you agree with. Because then you become in unity with that person. And if you come in unity with that person, you're going to reap what they've sowed too. Because now you're in unity with them. Hello. I remember Dad Hayden said he was in a group of pastors and they were talking about this, talking about that, talking about this, talking about that. And they asked him something. He just shook his head and laughed. They were talking about another pastor. He just shook his head and laughed. Got sick as a dog a few hours later. He went to the Lord. He said, what's wrong? He said, y'all were in there talking about my son. He said, I wasn't talking about him. He said, no, you didn't say nothing against him. You did shake your head yes and kind of laugh. He said, but you didn't stand up against them. If you knew they were doing wrong, you're supposed to stand up against them and say, that's not right. I'm not listening to you talk against this person or that person. You need to get to the Word. You need to get to Jesus because you ain't following him right now. They'll pray God anyway. That's the answer. Yeah. And guess what? When you start doing it, guess what's going to happen? They're going to hate you. I got people right now hate me. I don't even know why. Some of them, they just hate me. Why? Because when they ask me something, I'm talking about Jesus. Man, pray God. They don't like it because they tell them they got to come to church. Well, but I didn't say that. Didn't come up with it. Didn't write it. I just read what he wrote. Amen. So I pray God. Anyone who's not with me, next verse. I got to eat a nap. Let's wash him down. Protein. Therefore, I tell you, people will be forgiven every sin and blasphemy, but the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven. Man, be careful who you talk about. Next verse. He explains it to us here. He said, whoever speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit, it will not be forgiven him. Either in this age or in the one to come. Be careful you talk against the Holy Spirit. These denominations out there to talk against him, saying tongues of the devil, it ain't for this age. They better be careful what they're saying, because according to that right there, they can't even be forgiven for that. So better be careful when you talk against the Holy Spirit and say things against him that don't line up with the Word. And you ain't going to find nothing in the Word that lines up against him. You're going to find in the Word, follow him. Do what he says. The problem is, a lot of people think they listen to the Holy Spirit, and they just listen to a spirit. Because it don't line up with the Word. If it don't line up with the Word, it ain't him. It ain't him. What me and you say has got to line up with the Word. Amen. It's got to line up with this. So start talking like that when you go to work, go to family reunions, have people over for dinner or stuff, and write down verse 33 starting next week. And go to dinner and stuff, and man, see how much how long they really like you. I put it to the test, y'all. Get around people, start talking to Jesus, and they don't want to be around you no more. Why? They don't want to hear about Jesus. They want you to come down, call them to them, tell them how, oh, you're so right. You're so right. They shouldn't have done that to you. Just like I told Sunday about the event at work. Come home and talk about that lady. And I said, man, you got to forgive her and forget it. I love her just as much as I love you. Can you imagine what some of you people are talking? Did any of y'all ever had anybody talk against me to you? I mean, they talked to me against me. Wouldn't it be amazing if when they come to you, you said, man, I love Pastor Robert as much as I love you. That's what I tell people. I love them just as much as I love you. They don't get to partake in that much love that you do as my wife, my kids, or whatever. But the love, there's no difference.
Amen.
Amen. So that's what me and you got to get to. That no matter who it is, if they are in human flesh, we love them. Hallelujah. Anybody need to get saved tonight? Give your life to Jesus Christ? Anybody? Girl, you cold? Get that 6T dress next time, okay? Love you, girl. I'm going to look at that already. Anybody need to get saved? Give your whole life to Jesus? Rededicate your life? You know you ain't living right, and you want to get right with him and live from this moment on right? People ask me, why you give me an altar call every service? I said, because I was in church for 11 years, taught Sunday school, sang in team revivals, ministered the Word. And I said, I wasn't born again. People just can't get that. Well, there's a lot of them that go to church all the time ain't born again. That's why he's going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. That's right. You think they're saved, and you preach them right into heaven. They never gave their whole life to Jesus. They wasn't in a relationship with him. Just like I said, people go to church. What I read a while ago, people go to church their whole life, and their name ain't in the Lamb's Book of Life because they don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. They have a relationship with this world, the things they want to do, their job, their friends, and that's more important to them than anything Jesus has got to do. But that's got to flip in our life. Amen? Where he's the most important thing to me and you. Man. And I say that out of my mouth all the time. I've been saying it for years. He's my number one. But you find out if he is when something comes up that goes against what he wants you to do. Is he really your number one? That's the only time you find out. Loving one another, taking people's sin away, that's wonderful. As long as nothing happens to get on my bad side and I see whether or not I can forgive you, forget it, and let it go. That's the only time you know that verse is working is when somebody does you wrong and you just forgive them, forget it, and let it go. Amen? Well, we love y'all. See y'all Sunday. Don't see Dustin on Sundays. That'd be on a cruise. Hallelujah. So if any of y'all want to lead praise and worship, let me know. But make sure you can sing.